Andreas. As he said already, I live and work in Germany, in a small town in the outskirts of Düsseldorf. I'm not really used to giving talks at conferences, so please be patient with me, and I hope you can stand my accent for the next 25 minutes. This talk is obviously going to be about COTI. It will cover why COTI came into existence in the first place, who these giants are, on whose shoulders COTI is standing, how COTI is built on top of them, and finally, I'll show you some examples to make it easier for you to understand what it's like to work with COTI. So, yet another web framework, really. Aren't there already dozens or even hundreds of them? Why not just not pick one of them? As a matter of fact, all of the COTI core developers have some common history, and that history is Plone. Plone is a full-featured content management system. It has lots and lots of add-ons, and it has some unique features. One of them is the object file system, which is a simple yet effective way to persist objects. You can more or less store plain Python objects into an object database, and it supports a tree or file-like folder, folder and file-like object tree. Plone has some great security features. It has the concepts of groups, users, roles, and permissions, which enables you to write applications with very fine-grained security. Also, workflows are an absolute killer feature of Plone, of the underlying SOAP that was unprecedented at that time. So if you have a classic content management use case or you need an enterprise content management system application, it's probably a perfect solution. But if you need to implement a highly customized application with some CMS-like features, it can quickly become overkill and a major pain. It often has too many features out of the box that you just don't need, and you constantly find yourself fighting against the framework. This is particularly caused by the underlying software stack. The Plone system itself is huge. It consists of some 300 packages. It uses multiple competing technologies under the hood, which don't conform to the Zen of Python to have preferably one and exactly one obvious way to do things. It's based both on the monolithic SOAP 2 and the component-based SOAP 3 stacks. It uses adapters, multi-adapters, utilities all over the place. And long story short, it doesn't fit my brain. So, fortunately, there are smarter people than me who have similar history and wanted to preserve the most important features that SOAP pioneered back in the days. This all with a modern, clean, and maintainable code base. This was the birth of Pyramid, then known as Repose BFG. The probably greatest thing about Pyramid is it even fits my brain. It has a small core, it has excellent documentation, it is Pythonic and rather low level, which is why you can also sort it into the group of micro frameworks. And it's also unopinionated, which means it makes no assumptions about stuff like persistence and forms, and only basic assumptions about authentication and authorization, which you could call the least common denominator for all kinds of web applications. This all makes it a great framework, a framework to build your own framework which supports your opinions. So, Pyramid only provides what you need in every web application. It doesn't come with unneeded ballast, and there's no need to waste time fighting the framework's decisions. This makes it a perfect foundation for your own framework. So what's left to do is make some choices that Pyramid doesn't make for us by intention. Choices we need to make are about persistence. Obviously, you need some means of storage for most applications. Templating, forms, and user input validation, and authentication and authorization sources, amongst others. So, first, persistence. SQL Alchemy, it's probably the most advanced Python object relational mapper out there. It's completely database agnostic, meaning that it supports all your relational databases. It has many nice, useful features that Kotti makes use of, like hybrid properties, association proxies, and ordering lists. I won't go into detail here. And particularly useful is that transactions can be bound to the lifecycle of a pyramid request through the use of the pyramid TM and soap.sql alchemy packages. So what Kotti does is it implements a node class in pure SQL Alchemy that implements what we had with the object file system in SOAP. It follows the adjacency list pattern, which means every node in the tree knows about its parent and its children. There obviously is a single root node, the one which doesn't have a parent. And the node class also supports the dictionary protocol. Implementing the dictionary protocol means that you can treat any instance of the node class as kind of dictionary and get items by their name and key, meaning get children by their name, and you can also set them like you would with a dictionary. So this code here actually is working code in Kotti, which allows you to get a child of the root element or to add a new child to the root of type document. The dictionary protocol allows us instantaneously to, or gives us instantaneously traversal support with Pyramid, because Pyramid only requires an under get item method to be implemented, which is exactly what the dict protocol does. Beyond that, we also have an ACL property on the node class to have persistent and inheritable access control lists. In Kotti, SQL Alchemy is set up to do polymorphic queries. This means a single query can return objects of multiple types. For example, if you're querying for nodes, it will hand you back instances of document and file if that node happens to be of these types. Joint table inheritance is another nice feature in SQL Alchemy that we use in Kotti. It means that the class inheritance hierarchy is broken up among dependent tables. So each class is represented by its own table, and the respective table only includes attributes that are local to this class. The last feature of SQL Alchemy that I'd like to mention are events. SQL Alchemy has a lot of them, but in Kotti we actually only use one, the before flush event. A flush is basically the moment when SQL Alchemy talks to the database. It's not the same as a commit, it's rather SQL Alchemy emitting SQL and sending it to the DB, which can happen multiple times during a transaction. Of course, a commit always includes a flush. A SQL Alchemy before flush event can trigger multiple more nuanced events in Kotti. This is a mere convenience thing, so it eases you to have respective event subscribers. So not exactly part of SQL Alchemy, but only also closely related and also written by the same author, is Alembic. Alembic is a package, a database migration tool that supports transactional data definition language operations, if your database does support it, and transactional data manipulation language operations. Another useful feature is that it supports multiple environments. This comes in extremely handy for add-ons in Kotti. So each add-on can have its own migration environment, which is independent of the others. Kotti includes a script to perform either specific migrations or all migrations for itself and all its add-ons at once. You can either upgrade to a specific version or to the latest known revision. Downgrades are also supported by Alembic and also by Kotti for the case that something goes wrong during a migration and your database does not support transactional data definition language. So, user interface. Unless you have a user interface designer on your team and can be sure that he will stay, just use Bootstrap, you can't do much wrong with it. Next, forms. Most form libraries handle creation of forms as well as their validation. Colander and Deform are different in that aspect. With Colander, you can define the data schema, validate and deserialize HTML forms as well as JSON or XML data, and serialize Python structures to strings, mappings, and lists that can be consumed by Deform, which in form only renders the form. Deform 2 uses Bootstrap 3 out of the box. You could change that, but we don't need to because that's the choice we also made for Kotti. In fact, Deform 2 is a merge of Deform 1 and Deform Bootstrap, which was a package by the Kotti developers that provided Bootstrap templates for Deform 1. So, repost.workflow is another package from the Pylons ecosystem. A content workflow system that supports the concepts of states and transitions. States define roles to permission mappings, and transitions define transitions between these states and the circumstances in which they might be executed. And actually, this package allows us to implement the complete and exact feature set that we had in SOAP earlier. Depot is another giant that recently made it into Kotti. I won't cover that because I've seen there's a talk tomorrow at 11 in Barrier 2, so visit that one. And let's finally come to Kotti itself. As mentioned in the talk outline, Kotti is a rather small package that wires up all those giants in a sensible way. It was started in 2011 by Daniel Nouri, and he did the first version in just 2 days, and that already contained the node class with all its features. I learned about Kotti a year later and joined the project almost immediately. I'm skipping the rest because I'm running out of time already. Code quality is an extremely important thing to us. We have an extensive test suite based on PyTest. We make heavy use of reusable fixtures that are exported as a PyTest plugin that can be consumed by Kotti add-ons. We have continuous integration. We use some tools for static source code analysis. You shouldn't blindly follow all of their suggestions, but they can give very valuable insights on your code and help you to improve it further. So, and we also try to keep our requirements up to date and succeed with that until now. Kotti is exclusively configured through ini files. As Kotti is a plain pyramid and therefore also whiskey application, you can run it under your preferred whiskey server. Almost every aspect of Kotti can be configured with an option in these files. So Kotti provides sensible defaults for each option so that you don't have to specify any of them. But the important thing to take away from this is you can overwrite almost everything in Kotti, but you don't need to. I'm skipping those options also. So let me just give you one example of how we combine multiple best-of-breed components to a fully functional system. with regard to security, we use SQL Alchemy to store principles, that is, users and groups, in the database, and attach inheritable ACLs to each node. We use Pyramid for the process of authentication and authorization, and we use repose.workflow to recompute these ACLs on every workflow state change. So, code example. We provide a complete Kotti scaffold based on the pcreate tool from Pyramid with Kotti. And after running the command, you will have a fully functional add-on for Kotti with a complete test suite and continuous integration on Travis also set up already. That created package contains a custom content type, default and alternatives used for that type, completely set up internationalization structure, also a migration environment for use with Alembic. And that scaffold is also always kept up to date to adhere to the recent coding conventions as suggested by the Kotti team, and it's as well completely tested within our continuous integration infrastructure, so we can be sure that it works at any time. Okay, I have to run a bit through this. The custom content type looks similar to this. It inherits from Kotti's content class, which is again just the same default that you should probably inherit all your types from. It has a primary and foreign key to the parents table ID column that's needed for the joint table inheritance of SQL Alchemy. And then it adds the attributes that are actually added by this class in addition to the inherited ones. So last, there's a type info that tells Kotti how, where, and under which conditions that content type should be made available through the user interface, which then results in this dropdown. A Colander schema is responsible for serialization, deserialization, validation, and form creation through deform. It also inherits from the parent schema and only adds schema nodes that are provided by the custom content class. The add and edit forms, they're like everything in Kotti plain pyramid views that are configured by the usual view config decorator. The actual form rendering and validation is again provided by the base classes, so you don't have to write a single line of code for that unless you want something to be done differently. And what you see here is a complete and working example. There's nothing left out. So this is what the form looks like with a validation error. Yeah, last but not least, here's the code for a simple view. Again, just ordinary pyramid views, just like everything in Kotti. In this first view, there is a template specified for rendering. In Kotti, we use the Chameleon templating language, but you can choose anything that's supported by Pyramid. Okay, I have to come to the end. Okay, future of Kotti. Kotti will always stay lean and mean in all of the right ways, so there won't go any features into the core that can be packaged into an add-on. We're even thinking of moving some features out of the core into add-ons. For example, we have a mass file upload feature that requires some JavaScript libraries that are rather heavy and only required for that particular feature. So the primary goal of Kotti is to stay lean and clean. Yeah, and we don't have Python 3 support yet, but all of our dependencies right now support it, and it simply hasn't been done, but it shouldn't be a lot of work. And if someone would be interested in working on that during the conference, I'd be happy to team up. So, thank you. Try out yourself, and thank you for listening.
Thank you. So we do have time for questions about 5 minutes. So, any questions? Yes.
When representing metrics, how do we correctly measure what we care?
Thank you.
So with defining new content types, you have the polymorphic join that'll bring back the actual sub or the content types that you declare. As you declare more content types, on a lot of the COTI queries, is it doing a join across all those tables, and what's the impact on performance?
It depends how long this join gets, but actually modern relational databases are really good at this.
Okay.
So. It's never come to an issue for us yet, and we have quite large systems with a lot of inheritance and multi-billion rows, so it works.
Second question, if I may. So I downloaded it and was just looking at the debug output with a lot of the ACL checks for like a nested hierarchy of content, and it seemed to be querying the database for the same ACL validations quite a bit for different parts of the UI, so it didn't seem to be caching the result. Is that something that I was just noticing, or is it?
I don't know right now what you mean by that. You could show me later, perhaps.
Okay. All right.
Any more questions? We need to get it on a microphone, so it's.
Hello, thank you very much for the talk. So I'm not very familiar with all this technology, I just know the basics. What would be the major advantage versus Django or Flask, for example?
Yeah, you cannot probably compare it directly. You would compare Pyramid to Flask, which both are kind of micro frameworks. Django is more a macro framework, if you will, which contains its own ORM. And COTI is just a bundle of technologies that we use in combination with Pyramid. So if you like to use Pyramid and your preferred persistence layer happens to be SQL Alchemy, then COTI does a lot of things for you already that you can use.
Any more questions? I do have a quick one. What kind of applications do you make with this framework?
We do make all kinds of applications, some of them with large user-contributed content. We do make custom applications where a small part needs a content management system, but not a full-featured beast like Plone or Django CMS or something like that. The advantage is that the framework doesn't get in your way. So you basically have a plain Pyramid application with all you can do in Pyramid. COTI is nothing more. It doesn't add conventions. So it just configures Pyramid in a meaningful way.
Any more questions? I think we're good. So thank you again.
Thank you.